the role of a chair in a session like this is to be as quiet as possible and not to be a time and to be a time policeman. But I've talked to everybody here, and they've all crossed their heart and hope to die that they were not going to do more than 14 or 15 minutes, so I won't have to be a time policeman. Roughly the layout of this conference has been that in the morning, we tried to discuss some of the aspects of the problem of the working class. And as is normal in these conferences, you saw a very wide number of different looks from different angles. This session, which goes 2 hours and is kind of two sets of extremely eminent speakers, is what keeps it being that bad? Why doesn't it self-correct? Why doesn't it get better? And then the final one in the afternoon is what could actually be done about it? And we're going to do it. I don't think there was a particular order, so were you first?
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll start that way. And
should I just go? Or yeah. Here?
No, I'm done. So go up there, and just so that everybody knows, we're in the order we're going to do it. So.
All right, I want to start by invoking again what Phelps said this morning, which I think is extremely important, that jobs are not the same as a work culture. And I want to focus on a particular set of issues, which is not necessarily perhaps what Phelps had in mind when he asked me to speak. There you are, right. So I want to look at the intermediation function that enters into the picture really when we privatize, deregulate, and globalize, and how that actually installs an extraordinarily powerful work culture, but at a very high cost of other work cultures. Now, I want to start with a couple of slides, just to put us in the right mood. And what I would like to emphasize here, so as you can see, this is corporate profit after tax, etc. And at some point, the curve becomes very, very acute. Then we have the crisis. And after the crisis, and I think this is the point that I want to emphasize, it gets even better for this sector. And if you look at corporate assets, the crisis lasts about half an hour, I would say, that little wrinkle up there, and then it is even higher. Now, I juxtapose this trend to another trend, which is that, it varies a bit, but that certainly over half of the workers actually lost ground. Eventually, some of them may have recovered it. But these are two extremes. So from going where you have a big middle, you go to two extremes. I'm just using this as an example. And I want to throw in a third variable, which is that most of our governments, if I just take a very simple measure, actually became poorer, including, let's say, the German government, which after all is a very well-run economy. They have this intermediate manufacturing that means that there are very good jobs. There are work cultures in Germany. So even Germany, raises the debt. So, and we all know this graph. I don't want to dwell too much on this. But the interesting point here is clearly that in that middle, this is a graph that where you look at the 10%, top 10% earners, and by inference, you can see when they gain ground at the two extremes there, and when they lose ground. The loss of ground, we know from other data, represents the growth of a middle class and all kinds of actually very good work cultures. And when you read the books, the analysis of that time, sort of the notion, at least in some sectors, is we found the formula, because that was a good period in the American economy. There were strong work cultures, etc. We found the formula. We're not going to give it up. Well, before we knew it, we were back again up that way. And that is, I think, where we are still today, even though, as several people mentioned this morning, the United States has produced a lot of jobs. The question is, one way of putting the question, since we're at this particular meeting, is this question of cultures of work. what kinds of jobs. Now, so I want to then look at the question of finance, and I want to start by making an observation, which is that high finance is really different from traditional banking. The traditional banking is commerce. It sells money it has for an interest. We all need it, it's a productive function, it's good, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Finance at its highest, most complex, et cetera, is a brutal way of putting it, if I may, just for shorthand also, is that I like to say that while the traditional bank sells something it has, finance sells something it does not have. And in doing that, it needs to develop new instruments and it needs to invade other sectors. In other words, it financializes. In that capacity that it has, and in that thrust to financialize, and the value, as we know, of finance, if we take the traditional measure, outstanding derivatives right now is over a quadrillion. That is many times more, let's say, than the global GDP of all the countries in the world, or than all the currencies issued by all the central banks in the world. So finance is truly, you have to think of it as a capability. It can be good, it can be bad, but it cannot be flattened into money. Now, I want to move into this question of intermediation. And so when I was doing my research on the global city, I defined the global city function as an intermediation function. That meant that while time one, before globalization, the big corporations, just to take a simple example to make my point, there are many other aspects, but I just want to focus on the big corporations, basically did in-house whatever they needed done. And they had full-time staff, and it was actually, those were good work cultures. You had possibilities for moving up if you were good, you know, et cetera, et cetera. When you deregulate, privatize, and globalize, those same firms want to function in many, many different countries. Once you want to operate in 25 countries, 35, 48, whatever it is, you need that intermediation function. If you want to operate in Mongolia, but you only need 20 hours of the most specialized type of Mongolian accounting and lawyering, and you want to operate in Argentina, and you want the most specialized, you don't hire those people full-time in-house. You actually need a place where you can buy it all. And not one single firm can deliver all you need. So at that point, what you have is the installation in these cities of a major, I like to think of it as a platform, a knowledge platform, an operational field, whatever language we may want to use, where these corporations can buy whatever they need. Now, to me, that then also explains partly a couple of things that happen in major cities. Let's remember that when this new global era takes off in the 1980s, a lot of the big cities were poor. New York was bankrupt. London was poor. Tokyo was poor. Paris was poor. Let's remember that, because the dominant economic system had been marked by mass manufacturing, building up of suburbs, building infrastructure, et cetera, et cetera. Very different economy that barely needed cities. And the corporations, as I said, were quite self-sufficient. They hired in-house whatever talents they needed. Now, when this new epoch installs itself, globalization, this intermediate sector becomes the ascendant sector. And so that explains gentrification. I'm using this term for shorthand. I'm assuming everybody knows what I mean, right? You have an expansion of the demand for fancy housing. You have if you think of New York City, I remember I was in New York City when it was broke, and there was a lot of very poor areas that now are very chic areas. I don't think I need to elaborate, that's a known fact. But so what you have is really a whole new, I repeat, operational field installs itself there. It has the effect, of course, of also pushing out other kinds of sectors. And one issue that I think that is also very important is the franchising. So right now, almost everything happens via franchising, which means big corporations. I like to ask the rhetorical question, do we really need a multinational to have a cup of coffee? I'm talking about Starbucks, right? So that's sort of the image. So when you have franchising, you also need less talent. in whatever the small mom-and-pop shops. So before the flower shop, that was a culture, a work culture. They had to do everything. They had to decide, where do I find my flowers? How do I sell it? The accounting. There was knowledge. It was a knowledge space. The Italian coffee shop, you know, owned by a family over the, whatever, the centuries or the decades, there is knowledge there. That is a work culture. But when you franchise, you just the most elementary set of actions. And a lot of the more complex actions go to the headquarters. So there is a loss of capability. There is a loss of a work culture. And in some ways, there is a kind of an impoverishment as well. Now, when you take a city like New York, you have on the one hand that intermediation function, which, you know, its finance is the queen of the domain there. But there are super specialized lawyering, super specialized accounting, the advisors, the experts, you know, an extraordinary work culture, not necessarily the work culture that Phelps was talking about, but that is a work culture. And so the people who are in that work culture think this is fantastic. You know, they really, and a lot of young people, we all know that story, very smart, et cetera, et cetera. But then you have really the diminishing, the thinning out of that other workforce, which is also part of a city, et cetera, et cetera. And so I wind up sort of with a thought that one measure, if you want to, one instrumentality that we should really work at, I am very interested in certain activist networks, which is how do we begin to relocalize certain activities? We do not need Starbucks to have a cup of coffee. We can find a good Italian uncle who can do a good one, and, you know, whatever. I'm just exaggerating a bit the image. We cannot relocalize the production of computers, but we can relocalize a lot of stuff. Sort of, and the notion is to bring back a genuine work culture into the small shops, you know, the autonomous. You have that a bit in Brooklyn, ironically, today. Again, I'm talking about New York because here we are. That you have a sort of a recapturing of the pleasure of having your own shop and developing the knowledge that it takes, etc. You know, you even know that they installed their own digital network, you know, which goes only so far. But this sort of kind of notion. So to just shut up, I know, to make an end to it, I think that one of the elements that has been overlooked significantly is this juxtaposition of a whole new work culture through that intermediation function, which is also an urban knowledge function, because you need all these different forms of knowledge and you need all that diversity. There is no single firm who can deliver all of that. So very powerful, very admirable on some level, but also quite destructive of a whole other set of work cultures that simply have been diluted as a consequence and reduced to far simpler functions. Thank you very much.
So thanks very much for inviting me. I'm going to talk about a study I presented at the Boston Federal Reserve Bank a month ago, which has a title that they assigned to me, Where Have All the Workers Gone? I only tell you that in case you want to look it up. You can Google that. What I'm really going to talk about is observations on the slide in labor force participation and agency flourishing and prosperity. Labor force participation, as you probably know, is the sum of the number of workers who are employed and those who are not employed but actively looking for a job. Everyone else is out of the labor force. They could be out of the labor force because they're retired, because they're busy raising a family, because they're going to school, or because they got so discouraged they couldn't find a job, they gave up looking. and it's the latter group, I think, that is of great concern. I'm going to go through a whole bunch of slides, but I firmly believe I should tell you what I'm going to tell you first and then defend it. So first is labor force participation peaked in the US in the late 1990s, and it's been declining since then. These trends preceded the recession. in many ways, they just continued after the end of the recession. In the last year, there's been a 0.4 of a percentage point recovery in labor force participation that Matt Winkler highlighted. I suspect that's a blip. I say that for a couple of reasons. First, labor force participation is not very cyclical. Bob Hall has a study where he concludes it's not cyclical at all. I don't think that's the right conclusion. But labor force participation does not historically move much over the business cycle. And in particular, people who've left the labor force don't tend to come back when the economy gets stronger. And I'll show you something on that. And I think that means that we need to focus on the longer term trends, because even a stronger economic recovery is not going to do too much to reverse the trend that's been taking place. And it's traditional to look at different groups, to look at young people, prime age, men and women, older workers. And when I started this paper, I actually didn't have a strong view about which group deserved our most attention if we want to raise agency, flourishing, and prosperity. And I've concluded that it tends to be the prime working age men for reasons that I'll show you. If you look at young people, their labor force participation has declined, but that's entirely offset for women and almost fully offset for young men by an increase in school enrollment, which will ultimately, I think, improve their economic circumstances and their lives. Also, if you look at their subjective well-being, they look to be quite happy if they're out of the labor force. I'll show you something on that. Labor force participation has been declining for prime working age men, men aged 25 to 54, since we started collecting the data after World War II. And one of the things that I found in this study is that a large number of these men report a health problem, either mental or physical health. A high fraction are taking pain medication on a daily basis. Now, I don't know what has caused what. I don't know if health conditions have caused them to exit the labor force, or if being discouraged, being unable to find a job, led them to sit on the sofa all day long and become obese and have health problems. But I do know that these are problems that we need to address if we want to bring more of these individuals back into the labor force. And the prime age men express extremely low levels of satisfaction with their lives, and moment to moment are in a very low emotional state. If you look at women, the rise in labor force participation of women fueled the tremendous rise in labor force participation in the post-war period, but that came to an end in 2000. And it looks like it came to an end because of changes across cohorts of women. This was a generational development, which I think is going to be very difficult to reverse for reasons I'll comment on again later. And also, the women who are out of the labor force don't seem particularly discontent. Their subjective well-being is about as high as it is for employed women. Then lastly, I think this problem is going to be a continuing headwind for our economy. I think it's part of the answer for why we didn't have 4% growth. Because the population of working age is growing much, much more slowly. Aging is going to be a drag on labor force participation for years to come. So this is the labor force participation rate in the US, the share of people over age 16 who are employed or unemployed, and you can see it peaked in the late 1990s, and we have this little blip over the last year. This shows you the likelihood of someone who's not in the labor force coming back in. And there are two ways that someone who's out of the labor force can come back in. They could go immediately to employment, that's the green line, or they could go directly to unemployment to look for a job, that's the red line. The blue line is the sum of those two. And two things to observe about the blue line. First of all, it's pretty flat. Doesn't move with the business cycle. Totally uncorrelated with the state of the business cycle. Secondly, it's been drifting down. It's not surprising that it's drifting down because the group that's out of the labor force tends to be older, and older workers are less likely to come back to the labor force once they've left. Also, you'll notice that the blue line continued to drift down even when we saw this little uptick in labor force participation in the last year. Well, what caused the uptick in labor force participation? It's because the unemployed stayed unemployed longer. And in particular, the long-term unemployed who tend to drop out of the labor force the longer recovery goes on seems to have stabilized. Now, I think that's probably a temporary phenomenon. Most of this decline that we've seen in labor force participation, this 4 percentage point drop from the peak at the end of the 90s till now, is simply the result of an aging workforce. And that's really easy to demonstrate. What we can do, and lots of people have done this, is you take the labor force participation rate for different age and gender groups, and you multiply that by their share in the population. And then you could say, well, let's just take the participation rates that we had back in 1997 for each group and weight them by the share in the population in 2016. And if you do that, that accounts for 80% of the drop in labor force participation. So the lion's share of the drop in labor force participation that we've seen over the last two decades is because we have an older workforce and older workers are less likely to participate. But there have been some significant developments for different groups and some changes in trends for different groups. So this shows you men age 25 and over, women age 25 and over, that's green, and then 16 to 24-year-olds in blue. And as I said earlier, labor force participation for men had been declining for decades. For women, labor force participation rose, and that came to a peak around 2000. And over the last 8 years, labor force participation for women has drifted down at about the same rate as it's been drifting down for men. So I'll look at each of these groups in more detail and focus on prime working age men. This demonstrates what I mentioned earlier, which is if you look at non-participation, so this is 1 minus the labor force participation rate for younger workers, age 16 to 24, more and more of them have not been participating in the labor force. But if you count those who are in school as doing something productive, what you actually see is a decline in non-participation for women and a slight uptick for younger men. So that's, even though I think there are lots of concerns about the job market for younger people, the increase in school enrollment I think is a positive development for the U.S. And it's one that's taken place, it was a little longer to take place in the U.S. compared to other countries which had a very big increase in the payoff to education. So prime working age men. This looks just at men age 25 to 54, and you could see about 12% of men aged 25 to 54 are neither working nor looking for a job, and that has about doubled since the 1970s. I added questions to the American Time Use Survey as part of a project I was involved in about 6-7 years ago, and I finally have had the time to analyze the data. So this shows you from 2010, 2012, 2013, the fraction of prime working age men on the top, women beneath them, who say that their health is excellent, very good, good, fair, or poor, broken down by their labor force status. 43% of the men say that who are not in the labor force say that their health is fair or poor. That compares to 11% for those who are employed, or 15% for those who are unemployed. If you look at women who are out of the labor force, 31% say that their health is poor or fair. So the men look like they're more likely to report worse health. The current population survey has a set of questions about disabilities. Now, these are not ideal, but I think they're informative. They ask the person who responds, does anyone in your house have one of the following disabilities? Difficulty dressing or bathing? Are they deaf or they have severe difficulty hearing? Blind or severe difficulty seeing? Difficulty doing errands such as shopping? Difficulty walking or climbing stairs? Difficulty concentrating, remembering, or making decisions? It doesn't ask for each person one by one. It just asks kind of for the household roster. And I think it misses a lot of other disabilities. I'll come back to that. But if you look, 34% of the men who are not in the labor force report at least one of these disabilities. One in six of the men who are not in the labor force say that they have difficulty concentrating, remembering, or making decisions. Remember, these are guys 25 to 54. 20% say that they have difficulty doing errands. 20% say they have difficulty walking or climbing stairs. So a large share of them look like they have severe disabilities. I ask questions about whether they feel pain during daily activities. About half the time, this group as a whole, the group that's out of the labor force, reports feeling some pain. I asked about pain medication. So this shows you for men in blue, women in pink. I stole this from Bloomberg, by the way. They made a nicer chart than me. The fraction of people age 25 to 54 who said that they took pain medication on the preceding day, broken down by labor force status. 44% of the men who are not in the labor force said they took pain medication on the preceding day. That compares to 20% of employed men, 19% of unemployed men. So the group that's out of the labor force looks quite different. Women tend to take more pain medication than men, if they're employed or unemployed or overall, but that's not true for the women who are out of the labor force. The women who are out of the labor force are often taking care of the home, which is not so surprising. If you take that group out, they actually look a lot like the men who are out of the labor force in terms of their disability status and in terms of taking pain medication. Now, one thing I didn't know is what kind of pain medication. And I think one feels differently if somebody took a baby aspirin as opposed to oxycodone. So I did a follow-up survey of 571 men who are out of the labor force, non-labor force participants, aged 25 to 54. 47% of this group said that they took pain medication on the previous day, so awfully close to the current population survey. Then I asked whether they took an over-the-counter medication like aspirin or Advil or prescription medication. 65% of those who took pain medication said it was prescription medication. 36% took both prescription and over-the-counter. So this is a high fraction who are admitting that they're taking prescription pain medication on a daily basis. I presume that there are some who are ashamed to admit it as well. I asked, does pain prevent you from working on a full-time job for which you are qualified? 40% said yes. 66% of this group reported a disability. Now, I had the same list of disabilities as the current population survey, and I also gave them a chance to write in something else. 16% wrote in something else, like diabetes or a back injury or cancer. So it's possible that the group with the severe disability is a lot higher than the current population survey is measuring, or it's possible that this sample is somehow skewed in the direction of those with the disability. It's a giant mystery, and I can't say that I solved it, how these people support themselves. Only 35% are receiving disability insurance in my sample. That's a little bit high compared to other estimates. Other estimates are closer to 30%. Most of them are not married, so you can't say they're being supported by their wife. I once wrote about this for the New York Times. I used to have the economic scene column in the Times. I called it the Cramer effect, because if you watch Seinfeld, you can never figure out how Cramer affords to live in that nice apartment building. Let me say a little bit about women. This follows different birth cohorts of women. So women born 1941, 51, and so on. And I put a five-year window around that to increase the sample size. So the chart shows you the fraction of women, say, born in 1941, that's the bottom line in crimson, as they went from age 21 to age 75. And you could see that labor force participation rose as they grew older, particularly as they got to a point where their children were probably old enough to take care of themselves. Then it plateaued in the late 40s and started to decline. If you look at the cohort born 10 years later, the blue line for 1951, that's higher throughout the career, but particularly higher at the younger ages when it's more family raising ages. Same pattern if you look at the 1961 cohort. If you look at the 1971 cohort, that nudged up. That's the green line on top. But then if you look at the 1981 birth cohort, that's a little bit below the green line. So that says that the generations have stopped increasing. The rising tide of labor force participation for women came to an end across generations. In fact, it looks like there was a little bit of overshooting. So let me lastly turn to subjective well-being. And I worked for several years with Danny Kahneman and other psychologists to try to develop measures of experienced well-being, how people experience their time, how they feel from moment to moment. And there's another measure of well-being, which is an overall evaluation of your life. For experienced well-being, we have people fill out a diary, and then we ask them during this particular activity, how sad did you feel on a scale of 0 to 6, where 0 means you weren't sad at all, and 6 means that you were very sad. How much pain did you feel, where 0 means no pain at all, 6 means a lot of pain. How happy were you? How much stress did you feel? How meaningful did you consider the activity you were engaged in? That's the experienced well-being measure. The overall evaluation is a very old idea. It's from Hanley Cantrell, called the Cantrell Ladder. Please imagine a ladder with steps numbering from 0 at the bottom to 10 at the top. The top of the ladder represents the best possible life for you, and the bottom of the ladder represents the worst possible life for you. So this is self-anchoring. You're thinking about what's the best I can do. And then you can say, give a 10 if you feel like you're at the top, and a 0 if you're at the bottom. So what do we find? And these are a little hard to read, but I'll interpret them for you, and you can trust me or look at the paper. This looks at the young people, young men, age 16 to 24. Those who are out of the labor force are doing just peachy. They, on the Cantrell ladder, are above everybody else. They report an average of 7.4 versus 6.9 for the employed and 6.8 for the unemployed. By the way, one theme throughout this is the unemployed look pretty miserable. That's true for all of these groups, so I don't want to minimize that, but I'm focusing on labor force. Those who are out of the labor force moment to moment look like they're not worse off. There's no significant differences for the emotions moment to moment, and in fact, those who are out of the labor force are a bit less sad than the others, if you look at the young people. If you look at men aged 25 to 54, they look pretty miserable moment to moment. Their average rating on happy is 3.95 compared to 4.2 for the employed. They're actually more tired, even though they sleep an hour more on average. They're more stressed. They are much more sad moment to moment. They report much higher pain, and they don't find what they're doing very meaningful. All of those differences are significant between those who are out of the labor force versus those who are employed or unemployed. On the Cantrell ladder, interestingly, they report themselves a little bit better off than the unemployed. Now, one possibility is that they've kind of adjusted the scales because they don't think they can achieve all that much in their lives. I do want to mention this U index. This was an idea Kahneman and I had. The U index stands for unpleasantness. So we look moment by moment and say, what's your strongest emotion? Is it a positive one or a negative one? And if your strongest emotion is a negative one, we say that's an unpleasant moment. So this tells you that 22% of the time, 22% of their moments, those who are out of the labor force, the strongest feeling they're having is being sad or being stressed. That's stronger than feeling happy. That's the comparison we made. And there are some, I think, attractive statistical features of doing that type of a measurement, which I won't go into. What about older men? Well, they also look pretty unhappy if they're out of the labor force. Moment to moment, they are more sad and less stressed. More sad and stressed. But on the latter, in particular, they're closer to the unemployed than they are to the employed. Women. Young women who are not in the labor force are doing just fine in terms of their reported subjective well-being. Now, these are largely students who are in school, and you probably noticed as you walk around campus, there are a lot of parties that take place, and it's probably a lot more fun to be an 18-year-old going to Columbia than an 18-year-old working at Starbucks. Women aged 25 to 54, those who are out of the labor force don't look particularly different than women who are employed. They find what they're doing to be meaningful, partly, I think, because they're raising families. They're happy moment to moment. They're tired, which probably is because they're raising families. They don't report particularly high stress, and they don't really stand out in terms of being sad. And then if you look at the older women, they're even happier if they're out of the labor force than the employed and the unemployed women. On the Cantrell ladder, the average is 7.4. The moment to moment experiences look pretty positive for women who are out of the labor force, age 55 to 70. And then I have these beautiful charts that I won't go over, but this shows you the Cantrell ladder each step of the way, and it kind of reinforces what I said. I mean, the really interesting one is this one, looking at men who are on the left. Green is men who are out of the labor force, and they don't look particularly different than the unemployed in terms of their emotional well-being. Okay, so let me conclude. Economists are much better at surfacing problems and finding solutions, particularly solutions that anybody wants to implement. But I'll say a little bit about some possible solutions. I think that this work suggests that physical, mental, and emotional health problems are a serious barrier for work for many prime working age men. I think pain is a barrier to work. I think it's perceived that way by these individuals. I have a separate study in the journal Lancet looking at individuals who feel pain, how their lives differ from those who don't feel pain, and people who feel pain throughout the day live really restricted lives. They're much less likely to interact with other people. That's also the case for men who are out of the labor force. I don't know the direction of causality, and at a certain level it doesn't matter, because if you want to bring them back, you've got this problem to deal with. I don't know if the situation has gotten worse. We have a presumption that everybody's getting healthier, but I don't know if that's the case. Certainly there's a problem with opioid addiction. I think a stronger macroeconomy, as much as I would like to see it, is not going to be sufficient to draw many of these individuals back to the labor force. So that leads me to think about interventions like pain management, physical therapy, which gets people to interact with other people, mental health services. I think they could raise labor force participation and subjective well-being. And also, I think we should think more about preventative health care for this group so that the problem doesn't arise in the first place. Thank you.
Thank you. My talk today addresses the causes of the discontent so vividly expressed in the recent election. I begin by addressing first whether the decline in productivity since 1970, amounting to secular stagnation, is a significant factor. Given the enormous ups and downs of human history, including times of rapid advance, collapse, and renaissance, such a decline after 1970 would not be surprising, especially since in the period prior to 1970, the U.S. was the last country standing after World War II, during which we harnessed all of our scientific and manufacturing capability and continued to enjoy the spin-offs of DARPA in the immediate post-war years. By 1970, however, we were experiencing the effects of the economic stress and social unrest caused by the war in Vietnam and the ensuing drug epidemic. On Friday payday afternoons, drug dealers circulated through factory assembly lines, with the result that cars coming off those assembly lines on Fridays and Mondays suffered more frequent recalls than Tuesdays, Wednesdays, or Thursdays' children. Foreign competition in the auto, steel, TV set manufacturing, and other industries caused employment levels, for example, in the inner city of Chicago, to plummet, as William Julius Wilson showed in his classic study. The number of employed males per 100 females was cut in half, with dramatic social consequences still felt today. Simultaneously, however, 350 million people in China, India, and elsewhere began their escape from dire poverty. But is the post-1970 decline in productivity likely to endure? Productivity is, of course, notoriously hard to measure, appearing as a residual in most GDP calculations. As Professor Marty Feldstein has shown, attempts to measure changes in productivity directly by government agencies verge on the comic. An increase in prices for a product is assumed to be a measure of product improvement, when in fact it may well be due to an increase in factor prices or market power. As for GDP, it declines when energy-efficient products reduce energy consumption. Information technology provides enormous value but costs next to nothing and largely escapes measurement. Wages and prices stay the same, but the goods, but the goods produced improve by 3% per year, that is still a 3% tax tax gain to the consumer, tax-free. Of course, the economy and society in general is in a period of dramatic transformation, with radical technological advances in robotics, artificial intelligence, biotech, and material design, as seen, for example, in the Internet of Things, 3D printing, and digitalization. In every field, big data will transform learning. For example, in my own field, the study of the rise, fluorescence, and collapse of Bronze Age civilizations, the past 5 years have been transformative. between the DNA revolution and strontium isotope analysis, we know about the evolution and the diffusion of humankind and of animals and pathogens in ways unimaginable a few years ago. Recently developed methods of material analysis have contributed greatly to our knowledge of the movement of metals in terracotta transport jars and drinking vessels. Our new ability to visualize data and exchange information has been an enormous boom. Tasks such as comparing the information from two archaeological sites, which a short time ago would have taken a scholar 5 years with a doctorate at the end as a reward, can be accomplished in a day, and all the data can be stored in the cloud. How can we measure a transformative productivity gain of this nature? You may think this is a very specialized example, but what we've been able to learn about the peopling of the Earth and the role of climate change, for example, and the collapse of civilizations between 2300 and 2000 BC bears directly on today, as does what we've learned about the interaction between climate change and migrations. The abandonment of the Habur River Valley, which separates Turkey from Syria, and the collapse of the Akkadian Empire around 2200 BC, is closely paralleled by the terrible climate event in Syria of a few years ago, which led to the uprisings. And of course, who would have guessed that the exact strain of the bubonic plague, which caused the Black Death in Europe between 1347 and 1351, was exactly the same strain as the bubonic plague that caused the plague of Justinian, raising the question of whether there's a 1,000-year recurrence and whether we might have something to worry about. On a more mundane level, my dentist recently proudly displayed his new 3D imaging device, which took an image of my mouth and transmitted the image instantly to wherever, perhaps somewhere in India, where my false teeth would be manufactured. My dentist commented that the single device saves 20% of his overall time. How do we measure the benefit provided by painless dentistry? Quite a change from dentistry in my youth, and more broadly, the tremendous advances in medical care in general. The practice of law has also been transformed, for it no longer involves going to a law library, filling out a request for a casebook, waiting for the book to arrive, and repeating the process over and over, all in order to write a brief, which today can actually be written by a machine, resulting, incidentally, in a reduced demand for lawyers. Of course, dramatic changes in employment patterns are not in themselves new. In 1900, 48% of the workforce was employed in agriculture. Today, it is 2%. As you can gather, I don't believe a decline in productivity or secular stagnation is likely to be our problem. Rather, we must consider how to redeploy the workforce, distribute the fruits of increased productivity, and fill the leisure hours that the improvement in productivity provides. Today, 22% of working-age men in the United States are not in work, and the percentage of retirees in Western countries is expected to grow from one-fifth of the population to one-third. Accordingly, there will be jobs for the unemployed and caring for the elderly, and some of the jobs will require the physical strength to lift the infirm. Improving early childhood and schooling for the disadvantaged will require additional personnel in large numbers. Continuing repair of infrastructure will also require labor. Nevertheless, some predict that in the foreseeable future, 30% of activities and 60% of all existing jobs will be automated. In 1930, Keynes predicted that within a century, people would be able, on average, to work a 15-hour week, or 3 hours a day. He did not foresee a world in which some would work 100 hours a week, while many desperately wanting respectable work would be wholly unemployed. Earlier, the English philosopher T.H. Green had anticipated a world of increasing working class leisure time and pushed for the creation of Labor Party chapels stocked with the works of Plato and Aristotle, which workers could read when their shifts ended. The term chapel was taken from the Methodist chapel to which many workers then belonged. Alas, the Labour Party chapels, and most of the Methodist chapels, for that matter, have disappeared, and the works of Plato and Aristotle they contained can be found, as I once discovered, in the specialty bookshops of Hay on Wye and the Cotswolds. How to make work in the caring professions acceptable and desirable to macho working class white males and to provide satisfying leisure to those who can't find employment is a daunting challenge. Their resentment, indeed rage, at the loss of relative status was evident in the recent election, and the collapse into opioid abuse of a good number is a national tragedy. Joe Stiglitz has noted in the 2009-2010 recovery, the top 1% of US wage earners captured 93% of the growth. Resentment concerning the wealthiest 1%, whose lifestyles are so notably different from mid-range mortals, is also widespread. As Professor Krueger has noted, changes in earnings due to differing levels of education have played an outsized role in raising inequality within the remaining 99%, as poor non-working whites in Appalachia readily recognize. David Brooks has observed that some of them will say, "We're not word people," in expressing resentment that those with superior that only those with superior educations get ahead. In reading Brooks, I was reminded of my Navy days 60 years ago, hearing enlisted men in my division say resignedly, "I'm not well spoken." Recognition of the reality that only those with education prosper, while manual skills in many cases no longer seem of value, breeds deep resentment. Surely improving the education of the children of the disadvantaged from a very young age must become a national priority, at the same time as we embark on a well-conceived infrastructure improvement plan and training programs in the caring professions to absorb at least some of the adults currently unemployed. We face two daunting challenges. First, how to provide revenues for these programs, not to mention funds for strengthening both the Centers for Disease Control to deal with the threats of biowarfare and viruses and our cyber warfare defenses. And second, how to provide opportunities for personally rewarding, non-destructive leisure. As to the former, I would favor closing our enormous tax avoidance loopholes, such as carry interest, attacking rampant tax evasion, raising taxes on fuel consumption, and imposing a value-added tax, with lots of luck getting that through Congress. With regard to the use of leisure, provisions for adult education and for rewarding participation in public and charitable activities may be our best hope, together with the constant assurance that the lives and contributions of the less educated are valued by the whole society. Thank you.
I want to stick very closely to the splendidly Phelpsian title of our session, which is "The Current State of Forces Obstructing or Promoting Broad Agency and Wide Flourishing." The reason why this is a particularly powerful and poignant title is that we are now in a situation where the forces obstructing broad agency and flourishing are operating very powerfully for particular segments of the American workforce, the working class, large segments of the middle class, and this is producing the phenomenon of Trumpism and possibly the implementation of policies which are disastrous for the United States. I note, for example, the commitment to deport possibly millions of illegal aliens is still there. I also say that there is a kind of malignant dialectic between, on the one hand, the deteriorating economic circumstances of these segments and political attitudes. That if this dialectic continues unchecked in the future, we could surely expect these attitudes to become more extreme still, with disastrous consequences. So I want to look at the problem in the context of the role of technology in this, the role of technology in obstructing or promoting agency and flourishing. And I want to look at it in the context of what is known as skill-based technological change, which is the acronym which economists use very frequently in their analysis of this. Now, I'm going to argue for the concept of technological pluralism, that there are many different ways of using technologies, and they have different impacts on these segments of working population whose condition is very significant. There is an ambiguity in the concept of bias, which features in the acronym. Bias can refer to a scientific bias, something exerted by the laws of science, which perhaps the most dramatic of modern times is the bias observed in the orbit of Mercury, which proved definitively that Einstein's theory of relativity was correct. So here we have bias of a high order. Lower down the scale, we have the biases of human prejudice. We have racism and sexism and ageism and classism and all the rest. And I want to argue that biases of both kinds are at work in the causation between technology and work. Certainly, you can think of biases which have a kind of scientific inevitability. When the internal combustion engine came in, the horse went out. When the automatic telephone exchange came in, the telephonist putting the leads into the holes went out. Those jobs simply disappeared. But I also want to argue that there is a huge range of the economy and the workforce where there is the potential of a plurality of technological regimes. And we have to look and see how American capitalism in particular makes the choice. And I was particularly impressed by the presentation of Henry Kressel this morning, because in the extremely melancholy listing of forms of technology production which the United States did not pursue, certainly, as Kressel said, there was a lack of capital, but I would also argue that there was a systemic choice not to make the investments in skilled workers which was necessary to achieve those levels of production. So it goes to Korea and Japan. So we're getting into the idea of plurality of technological regimes. So I want to talk about this concept in the service sector. Kressel's dealt very well with manufacturing. I want to talk about services, and I want to bring in robots, not because I fear the rise of the robots. But what robots do is to focus the discussion on agency. It seems to me one of the weaknesses of the discussion of technology is that the language we use is much too general. We talk about hardware and software, we talk about expert systems, workflow management systems, surveillance systems, we talk about enterprise resource planning, business process re-engineering, and so on. And there's a kind of abstractness about all this removed from agency, which after all is what we're concerned about here, thanks to Ned. And robots are about agency. Robots do things. Whether you're talking about a physical robot picking up the boxes at Amazon Corporation, or whether you're talking about a virtual robot like the iconic HAL in 2001, who is directing the spaceship but is not a discernible physical entity. He's buried in the spaceship. And I want to talk about virtual robots because their scope in the economy is enormous. And I'm going to stretch the definition of a virtual robot to include something like the giant robot which runs, let's say, an Amazon fulfillment center. I mean, ultimately, Jeff Bezos determines the regime, but robots are his agent in doing it. So it seems to me that there are four possible ways of interacting between humans and robots, and they all have a bearing on this concept of pluralism. Number one is where the robot displaces the human entirely. And the example which I think of is the extremely irritating and dysfunctional robot which Amtrak insists on having when you ring up to find about the time, it's called Julie. I've been dealing with her for 20 years. She is inefficient. I would be just as irritated if it was Julian or John. So it's not a question of sexism. So we have the replacement of a human by a robot. We have situations where the employee remains, but the robot is hegemonic. And this is the situation in a great many call centers when the agent is simply a mouthpiece with the verdicts delivered by the robot in the form of an expert system. We also have situations where the relationship between the employee and the robot is turned on its head, that the employee remains hegemonic and the robot is subordinate. The robot has information, data, which the skilled employee can call upon. And I'm going to give an important case history of that. So those are three ways in which humans and robots interact, and I hope it gives a sense of the potential for pluralism in the nature of the technology regimes. The fourth is ignored by economists, but in a way, it's the most important of all. And I call it not skill-based technological change, but pace-biased technological change, because one of the things that robot systems do is to determine the pace of work. And that is a primordial issue affecting the quality of work in the workplace, stretching back to the age of Ford and Taylor, stretching back actually to the textile mills that Marx wrote about in Das Kapital. The pace of work is a primordial issue bearing on the dignity of employees in a fundamental way. And so I would simply describe, when you're looking at pace regimes, what is going on at Amazon. Amazon is a corporation which pushes the pace at its fulfillment centers to the limits. And here is an example of technological pluralism, which is aberrant. And there are a number of consequences of that which need to be mentioned. Number one, there is a great deal of empirical evidence that these regimes wear out employees. By the time they reach 40 and they've been working in the fulfillment center, they begin to wear out, so that they're on the slag heap, as in Marx's textile mills in the mid-19th century. Another aberrant characteristic of these pace regimes is because they are so demanding, employees fail to make their targets, same at Walmart, and therefore they begin to accumulate demerits. Both Walmart and Amazon have elaborate systems of demerits, and so employees, even if they are motivated, begin to accumulate a record of demerits, and the economic consequence of that is they begin to fear their security of employment and that their confidence in asking for pay rises diminishes. The fourth consequence of pace regimes, we have to go a little bit further up the occupational hierarchy, let us say to doctors. And if you look at some of the most brutal HMOs, what happens is that the pace regime, the allocation of inadequate time for doctors to see patients, means that they cannot exercise their skills adequately. They have the skills, but they can't exercise the skills adequately. So I've described a pace regime which, it seems to me, the case that it should be replaced by something more humane is overwhelming. And there's a compelling case history of this right now, because in Germany there is a slow-moving but titanic struggle between Amazon and the great German service union, the Berlin's Leistungsgesellschaft, whose struggle is to change the pace regime so that the German employees of Amazon have a dignified life in the workplace. And to my mind, it's rather disgraceful that you haven't seen a comparable movement in the UK or the US. And the answer to that is that the union movement is not strong enough to do it. So here is a regime, a technology regime among many, and there's the potential to choose between them. I didn't know how much time I have.
Take 3 or 4 minutes.
Okay. So let me finish by citing another case history which is very significant. And here we're moving from pace were moving back to skill. And as you recall, I said that there was a difference between regimes where the employee is hegemonic and the robot is subordinate, and regimes where the robot is hegemonic and the employee is subordinate. And there is a marvelous case history which shows the struggle between these two concepts being fought out. And it's what happened at Xerox PARC. Xerox's research center, the Palo Alto Research Center, for about 15 years in the late 80s and in the 90s, under the leadership of an extraordinary figure called John Seely Brown. And PARC really performed the function of one of the great German engineering unions, insofar that it wasn't a union in the technical sense, but its whole impact, its input, was to try and change the technology regime where employees were hegemonic and not robots. And so there's a tremendously important body of research on this. Basically, the struggle was that the Xerox Corporation wanted to impose an expert system which was Tayloristic in its inspiration, imposing a code of practice on the technicians of Xerox. And what PARC wanted to do was to turn the tables so that the expert system became a system for experts, and where the primary thing was the expertise of the technicians, who then drew upon the expert system to supplement their expertise. And guess what? The productivity of the technicians increased significantly. But as far as I know, that is a very rare case history in American corporate history. But the point I wish to make in terms of the pluralism of technology regimes is that there is a pluralism. Those are two regimes for using the same, basically the same technology. One enables the workforce to flourish in the Phelpsian sense. The other reduces the workforce to being subordinates of robots. So I ask the question, which is better, which should be working towards, and which will head off the working class from supporting Trump. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're gonna flip now, and we'll keep a Q&A if we can hold it to the end of the whole thing.
Thank Ned Phelps for the invitation to participate today. My comments really are certainly about the theme of this afternoon's panel about forces obstructing or promoting agency and flourishing. I suppose my remarks are going to be more on the obstructing side, given some of the issues I've been studying for a long time. As a very quick background, my most of my professional life for 25 years almost has been and will soon again be spent as an academic and a professor. But for the last almost 3 years, I've had the good fortune to serve in President Obama's administration in the Department of Labor, leading what is called the Wage and Hour Division, which is the part of the Labor Department that enforces our most fundamental labor standards around minimum wage, overtime, child labor, guest workers, prevailing wage, family medical leave. And serving in that post has given me certainly an eye-opening and remarkable perspective on how the forces I'm going to talk about are playing out in the workplace in a wide variety of industries and in a wide variety of contexts. There's a lot to talk about. I think I have 10 minutes. Alan Krueger and I were on a panel in this room about a month ago with the eminent economist Bob Solow.
14 minutes,
oh, great. And Alan and I and another economist, Sue Houseman, spoke, and then Bob Solow spoke last, and he said, I'm going to do two things different than the other panelists. The first is keep to my 10 minutes, and then he said something else equally wise. So I will keep to my 14 minutes. But what I want to discuss is something I have been studying for many years, and that is thinking about one of what I would argue one of the most fundamental forces that have changed the way employment happens, which then has repercussions for how workers are paid, how opportunities present themselves in the workplace, and in many ways the dangers and the risks that are increasingly faced by a substantial portion of the workplace in ways that I think have been alluded to by a number of the speakers this morning and in this afternoon's panels. And I've chosen to call this the fissured workplace, and I've used that term really to, in one way, encapsulate a wide variety of phenomenon that people have been thinking about and studying for some time. So that includes outsourcing, subcontracting, the increasing use of third-party management. Saskia mentioned franchising as another form of this. A whole range of business practices that have become more common in a growing variety of industries that have, as I'm going to argue, pretty profound impacts on the structure of employment and ultimately on agency flourishing, earnings, and fundamental issues of the workplace. So let me describe the fissured workplace by an example I often go to, because I think it's something we all experience as given our occupations, we all do a lot of traveling. And the hospitality industry is really an exemplar of these changes. And that is, when we go into most major hotels now around the world, we are walking into a hotel that has a brand. And that brand has a distinctive set of offerings for whatever customer base it's focused upon, whether it's a high-end, medium, or economy kind of hotel brand. But the common feature is everything you experience in that hotel will be, if the hotel is doing what it should be doing, consistent with that brand image. And so whether it is the way you're greeted at the door, the way your bags are taken to your room, the nature of the reservation process, the room you go into, the number of pillows you find on your bed, a lot of things you don't see but affect your stay, how long it takes to clean your room, the kinds of things that are provided in your room, the checkout procedures, all of those are very much guided by the brand. And it leaves us all with the notion that everyone employed in that pursuit of providing us that hotel service are operating under the same brand and employment that the marquee says. The reality is that's not true. Whereas in 1980, about 2% of hotels in this country, hotels and motels, were franchised. Today, more than 80% are franchised in branded, and with franchising has come an entire restructuring of the way hotels are administered. Because when you franchise, you're typically the property is owned by one group of investors, often private equity or real estate investment trusts, other parties, who in turn farm out the management to a very large sector of the economy that does third-party management, who in turn increasingly use a wide range of subcontractors, sub-franchised groups, and often staffing agencies to actually do the work in the hotel. And so what you might perceive as a single service is in fact being provided by a whole range of different business entities, but those entities all operating within the very strict quality technical standards of the lead company. And what I just described to you is a microcosm of what I would call the underlying recipe of the fissured workplace, which has three elements. Number one, it is driven and has been driven by particularly pressures. We've also heard some about this in the previous presentations. Private and public capital markets that have put pressure on businesses to focus on what we call in business school core competencies. And that focus on core competencies has been really a singular pressure on many corporations across the economy. That in itself, there's nothing wrong with that. I'm trained in economics. I teach in a business school, and that's sort of basic to lots of business models, although it's been intensified. The complexity comes in the fact that with that focus on core competency, there's been an increasing movement out of the activities to deliver that to more and more different companies. And so with the core competency, companies began on shifting out activities that we might all agree at the beginning were less central to what they were trying to do and might actually gain from hiring of a specialized entity to do that. But increasingly, that shifting out went to more and more of what we would regard as the core activities of that company. Now, that's the second element, this shifting out of activities. The third element I would cite is really to keep those first two elements really are in tension with each other. You need some kind of organizational glue. You need some mechanism to make sure the core competency isn't undermined by the use of third-party agents to do that work. And that is the glue of the fissured workplace is a combination of business organizational structures, franchising being a preeminent one, other systems of standard promulgation and enforcement that keep the thing together. That plays out in lots of different ways. Because of the limits of time, I'm not going to go into lots of different examples, but we heard from Simon Head about the distribution centers of more and more major, whether it's a retail distribution center in a brick and mortar space or those in the digital space. One of the fascinating things that's happened, and we see it as I've studied it before and I have seen it as in my enforcement agency capacity, distribution centers are very, very complicated, automated, capital-intensive operations where there still is a fair amount of manual work that really very quickly, because of just-in-time production and delivery, quickly take incoming trucks of merchandise, either coming domestically or through international shipments and containers, break it, move it very rapidly to the store where it will be directly provided. If you look just like looking behind the scenes in a hotel, if you look behind the scenes in major distribution centers across the economy, what you see is the actual management of that is done by a third-party logistics company, usually very large players, hired by the retailer, who in turn use systems of temp firms to actually directly employ the workers who do that work. And so you have multiple tiers of, again, entities, each requiring their rate of return to do their work, engaged in the ultimate delivery of that activity, again, under the very stringent specifications of the retailer, core to their strategy. I could also cite to you another example, the explosion of the iPhone originally, as you remember in ancient history when the iPhone was first introduced. Apple had an exclusive arrangement with AT&T. AT&T was required to drastically increase its cellular network, both expanding it and maintaining it. What AT&T did, again, was another version of the fissured workplaces when driven by subcontracting, where they used a major company regionally based to basically provide assurance to AT&T they would deliver these services within AT&T's very stringent specifications. And that work was then subcontracted out to multiple levels below that. My observation would be in all of these systems, there are reasons why businesses can do that, and that's why, again, I think we have to understand the systemic changes that drive it. But you can also quickly see as we create these multiple levels of employment with workers who ultimately are doing the work distanced from the company that is gaining most of the value, you have a setup for lots of problems. For purposes of the agency I run, we see wide-scale violation of these most basic labor standards, payment for hours worked, compliance with the ridiculously low federal minimum wage, certainly the payment of overtime hours, that really is a natural result of having a lower tier employer in head-to-head competition of a homogeneous product with a large labor content. That is essentially a formula for noncompliance. We find coordination problems. The example I just gave you of the cell phone industry, cell tower workers are the second highest fatality rate group now in the country, second only to taxi drivers, and have a fatality rate that is three times the level of underground coal mining at its peak. And so we have health and safety problems. And then finally, first I would point to some significant research about the importance of these arrangements. And this is from research that Alan Krueger and Larry Katz have done, looking at the growth of alternative work arrangements over the period of time between 2005 and 2015. And at least in the latest revision I've seen of their study, they estimate that between that decade, 2005 and 2015, somewhere between 80 and 100% of net employment growth is characterized by these different forms of alternative work arrangements, which says these kinds of practices and their impacts on wage structures, on the flourishing of work and the opportunities of work, are something that has become a much bigger feature of the workplace in our society. So the final thing I would just note in keeping with the discussion, and Ned Phelps discussed inequality as well as agency in his opening remarks today, I am, maybe because of the hat I currently wear, deeply concerned about inequality as an end in itself, as are many certainly in the administration and elsewhere. But also, I think this applies to its impact on agency and the nature of work. I think the fissured workplace potentially and currently, and there are papers that suggest already in our own data that this is happening, is a driver of, an important driver of increasing earnings inequality. And not so much because of increases arising within firms, greater distance between CEO pay and median pay of workforce, which has also increased, but because the fissuring I've described creates what I sometimes think of as a big bang in the structure of employment, where you have firms providing these lower level activities spreading out in the economy increasingly from those that are providing higher level of activities, leading to earnings inequality and a whole range of problems. There are other aspects that I could talk about, but I will close at that. Thank you.
My name is David S. Rose. I am one of these things is not like the other that is here. I'm not an economist. I'm not a PhD. I'm not an academic. I'm not a government official. I am a poor, measly working man toiling in the fields of entrepreneurship. And that gives me a slightly different perspective, I think, than most of the people in this room. So what we've heard today has been absolutely fascinating. Everything that I've heard strikes me as being accurate and interesting, and I follow along with it. And now I want to challenge you by saying I think that virtually every single thing we've heard today so far has been irrelevant, or effectively in the large picture of things is irrelevant, because the larger picture is much bigger than we understand it to be. In fact, I think you can look at all these challenges that are facing everything we have seen, every topic of this conference, and everything that's affecting society in terms of economics, and being driven by two different things. And neither of those two things has ever appeared in any academic program, books, or discussion that I have read on the subject. So I am going to try and ask you now for the next 14 and a half minutes to wipe your minds, as my young daughter used to say, and look at everything from a completely fresh perspective. One of these two things is the question of exponential technological growth. And the leading evangelist for that, and the person who's written most about it, is a guy named Ray Kurzweil, who wrote a book called The Singularity is Near. So I'm going to start off by giving you some of Ray's slides, with his permission, about the concept of exponential growth. The reason this is so important as an underpinning of everything we're thinking about is that we as humans are not used to thinking exponentially. Historically, prior to the Industrial Revolution, people thought of things linearly. It's absolutely flat. The technology that existed when you were born was the technology that would exist when you died. The world was static. Since the Industrial Revolution through the 20th century, we have been in a world of change. Technology has been changing, and you can expect that the world that will be there when you die is different from the world that was there when you were born. Do you remember the GE Carousel of Progress at the World's Fair in Disney World? There's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow. It's coming in every day, and everything changes in a generation. We look at this, internally think about this as a linear change. It's going from here to there, and it's a straight line path. And as humans, we think of things linearly, not exponentially, but there's a real difference. And that is, if you take a look at what happens when you move linearly, if you go out one and you go up one, and out two and up two, and out three and up three, that's the bottom curve there, that orange curve. That's a straight line, a linear line, one, two, three, four, five. But if you go exponentially, if you double things, you go 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 122, 56, 5, 12, 10, 24, and all the way up, you know, 1 gigabyte, 2 gigabytes, 1 megabyte, 2 megabytes, shoo! And it is this extraordinarily different. Take a look at that curve. This is what's known as a power curve in engineering, and it's what happens when you go exponentially instead of linearly. And getting that into our head and understanding that the effect of that growth in technology in the 21st century is fundamental to everything is the first step in putting all the stuff you've heard today into perspective. Now, how many people here have heard of something called Moore's Law? Raise your hand. Just want to get a quick take. Okay, I'd say about 2/3 of you. So Moore's Law, Gordon Moore, who was the CEO of Intel, observed retrospectively that the number of transistor equivalents that Intel could fit on a chip was actually doubling every year, which was a very interesting fact that he noted. And so therefore, it turns out that even though that's doubling, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, if you graph it on a logarithmic scale instead of a linear scale, it turns out to be a straight line. So a straight line on a log scale, and you can see the power of chips over there, of integrated circuits, is one that is doubling now every 18 years. And the interesting thing is, what happened before there were integrated circuits? Well, there were other technologies. And so this was a paradigm shift. And so what Ray Kurzweil did was to take Moore's Law and go backwards and say, hey, what happened before you had that shift into integrated circuits? And he looked at all the technology of the 20th century, and it turned out that there were multiple paradigm shifts in the 20th century. Going from electromechanical things, Hermann Hollerith inventing punch cards with IBM in 1908, to relays so a small impulse could change a larger load, to vacuum tubes that could store a bit of data. And each of these things revolutionized and helped to double the power effectively of computing or decision making. And over time, when it reached the apotheosis of that one particular technology, a paradigm shift would come into play and another technology would take over until it reached its limit. And then so on and so forth, you'd have multiple paradigm shifts. The result of these, Kurzweil noted, was that you can do a straight line on a logarithmic chart for the 20th century, and technology has effectively been doubling once you generalize it since the beginning of the 20th century. And that caused him to think, hey, wait a minute, if this went that far back across five different paradigm shifts, what would happen if you look further back in history? And it turned out that the law of accelerating returns of technology shows that technological change is and has always been exponential instead of linear, and that's really hard for us to intuit. But the result of that, once you start thinking in terms of exponentials, is that the rate of technological change we're experiencing in this century, the 21st century, won't be like the last century. It will be the equivalent of 20,000 years of progress as we know progress today. So what Kurzweil did was he then went back and said, okay, let me make a list of every single change, you know, the major paradigm shifts in history, whether it's in, you know, the finding fire or the Bronze Age or making tools or all the way through the Industrial Revolution. And he charted, he took everybody's list, 15 different lists from 15 impeccable sources, and he took all the items and graphed all of them. And son of a gun, it turns out that the time between paradigm shifts, that's the left-hand side over there, on an exponential scale measured in years, and the time before in the time of the present over time, elapsed time, also exponentially, is up front. So if you take a look at this chart, you are looking at every major paradigm shift in history that is moving exponentially. So what does that mean? Now, the rate of paradigm shift is actually doubling every decade. And that's caused in a very large part by technology, information technology. And information technology is doubling every year. Price, performance, capacity, bandwidth is doubling every year. Now, this is not a tech conference, so I'm not going to give you all of Ray's slides and walk you through all of the detailed stuff that he wrote about in his seminal book, The Singularity is Near. But just so this is an academic conference and I can have some credibility over here, let me just give you a few slides to show that no matter what you look at, no matter whether you're talking about supercomputer power, transistors per chip, or process performance, millions of instructions per second, or RAM memory, whether you're talking about manufacturing costs are dropping like a rock, whether you're talking about the cost of memory going down, whether you're talking about transistor prices, microprocessor clock speeds, transistor clock size, everything, any which way you can measure information technology, it is following this exponential curve. And that means you have to think exponentially about every single thing that is happening. So this is the total number of bits of information, on, off, yes and no's, that are shipped online. Going back from the 1970s when you had slow computers, who remembers dial-up modems? Now you have super duper high speed 1 gigabit things that are going into your home, into your eyeglasses, into your phone all the time. And so all of this technological advancement ultimately comes down and affects economics. Can't avoid it. Because what is happening? You're seeing this technology go into every single field of endeavor. And what this means is that the cost of producing all of these things, the cost of creating value, is also dropping exponentially. You're talking about, over time, the amount of any value in a product being moving increasingly to information. And information is advantaged by technology. And so, therefore, you're looking at the cost of this information dropping by 50% a year, while at the same time it's exponentially growing into the rest of society. An extraordinary deflationary force here. And you can look at this in terms of manufacturing output per hour, which is following this logarithmic scale all the way up. You can look at this in terms of e-commerce revenues that are growing really rapidly. You can look at the percentage of the economy that is information technology, which is increasing logarithmically. So there, exponentially. So therefore, fix that in your mind, that we are in this extraordinary power curve of technology driving everything. It's driving, it's changing the value equation, it's changing pricing, and it's changing unemployment. And so what does that mean? And now we go off of Ray's thing and we come to my world. And so if you extrapolate from all that, look at now what is happening. All these things we've seen about jobs, everybody we've heard today has been looking at job growth or job loss or changes in jobs in the last decade, the 20th century, since the Industrial Revolution. Think about this all the way back to day one. And so look at all these jobs that are progressively being eliminated or reduced by technology. Mining and manufacturing, all those mining jobs in Appalachia, agricultural jobs replaced by giant combines disappearing. Manufacturing, we know what's happening. First they were replaced by Chinese cheap labor, now then Korean cheap labor, and then they're replaced by robots right now, disappearing. The service industry, remember when you used to go on a trip, you'd call your travel agent and you'd go check in at the airport, you'd have somebody take your ticket, you'd go, all that is now gone, all done on your phone, all done, the service industry is disappearing. The intermediary industry, all of those stockbrokers and real estate brokers, all of those people who are between you and other taxi dispatchers, anybody who's an intermediary, going. And people who are managing all those people. Newsweek had a great cover story 8 years ago that said the most endangered species in America is the beached white male. He's 40 years old, had a big job and a big office, and now he's washed up with no place to go. So those are going. Oh, well, we're up to the top of the pyramid here. Well, that leaves it for those STEM folks. And even STEM jobs, which used to be more engineering, are now increasingly going up and up and up the spectrum, requiring more advanced degrees and so on and so forth. So what then is at the very top over here? Well, okay, this brings me to my second major thing. Once you've got the exponentials down, that second piece, that tippy top of the pyramid of this particular pyramid, not life in general, but this period, pyramid, are the entrepreneurs. And so some people believe in the great man school of history or the psychohistory school of history. I believe in the entrepreneurial school of history. And I think much of the advancement in history is caused by entrepreneurs. I'm an entrepreneur, natural born entrepreneur, started my first company when I was 10 years old. I was a finalist for the EY Entrepreneur of the Year Award of the 1990s. My father, who you'll hear from tonight, won it in 2003. We are natural entrepreneurs. You stick me on a desert island, I'll be selling coconuts to seagulls. That's what I do. Entrepreneurs thrive in an era of uncertainty. And so who is going to be here in this, when the paradigm keeps going, next paradigm shift happens, when all of these jobs disappear? Entrepreneurs, like cockroaches, you can't kill them. We thrive in uncertainty. And so then who? We employ those STEM people, the professionals, the creatives, the people in this room, the academics to teach the next generation, right? So everybody in this room is fine, no problem. But then this technology has created a third class, which I think is fascinating. And that's what I have dubbed entrepreneurial personal producers. These are the Uber driver who borrows money, gets a car, and then makes sure that they have a USB charger in the car, that they put out mints. It's the Airbnb host who takes a spare bedroom, advertises the right way to get more clients. It's the barber who makes sure that his Yelp rating is a 5-star one, so his brand is being built personally. So I think you're going to see this increasing world of entrepreneurial personal producers who are physically put into space by technology and who have that augmenting what they are doing. They're not entrepreneurs themselves, but they can work within the construct and the paradigm of these larger platforms. Okay, what comes next? Nothing. There is no next, because after that, you've got the unemployable. And that's what the problem is with this entire conference that we're talking about. We are in an exponential time, and we are heading to the point where these folks are unemployable. What are my quick guess is the percentages over here? They're 1% of the world are entrepreneurs, real serious entrepreneurs, okay? That's about, a lot of people tend to agree on that number. I think you're gonna find maybe, if you squint and look really, really hard, you can find 9% of creative professionals and STEM folks out there. And this new class of entrepreneurial personal producers, people who are toward the end of the spectrum. And I think that that's maybe 20%. So what does that mean? You get rid of all those guys, and what you have left are 70% of the population is going to be not able to create enough value to pay for their existence on the planet, and this is not happening years and years from now. I think you will see this within the next 5 to 10 years. Because if you look at this exponential technological change while we're, you know, fiddling while Rome burns over here, we are looking at a world that is fundamentally changing. And that's the bad news. Now, the good news, the little bit of good news, and I have 2 minutes left and I'll bring it home here, is that if you follow Kurzweil's thing and if you follow the works of people like Peter Diamandis from the XPRIZE Foundation, who wrote a book called Abundance, the good news is that as this extraordinary technology changes, you go past this bad stuff, nobody has to work. You'll be able to take on all of the solar power and power the entire world, and computers will generate the next generation of food and houses, and we'll all be sitting back like in the movie Wall-E in beach chairs sipping sodas and watching TV over here. You'll effectively have the Matrix. And that's when the next paradigm shift comes, according to Kurzweil, when computers and humans merge. And when is that happening? Well, once you get your head around exponentials and understand how fast this is changing, Ray Kurzweil predicts that the next paradigm shift, when computers and humans merge, and that is the technological singularity, that will happen in 2045. Folks, that is 29 years from now, 28 years from now, certainly in my working lifetime, and probably in that of most of the people in this room. So that's the good news. It's all going to come out really well if we can figure out how to get from here to there, and that is the challenge that we're all facing. Thank you.
Now Professor Cramer is going to tell us how all those nice folks in the towns in Wisconsin are going to...
Hello, everyone. I am Kathy Cramer. I am coming to you from Madison, Wisconsin. It is a real honor to be here. Thank you for inviting me. I have learned a great deal today, and I hope that I'm able to add a bit to the conversation. When I thought about the question of the potential flourishing of the working class, the question that comes to me is just, what role do the perspectives of people in the working class play in their flourishing or not? So I am a public opinion scholar, and what I have studied my entire career is how people understand politics or interpret politics. And so what I'm going to share with you is what I've learned over about the past decade about the perspectives of particularly rural working class white folks in Wisconsin. This is a population that became extremely relevant a little more than a week ago. So I hope to shed some light on what the Trump election means and how it has occurred. So I want to show the map of the United States to you because I am in flyover land. Wisconsin is in flyover land, and I thought maybe it might be worthwhile to remind you where it is. It's right here. So what I did in 2007, I had just earned tenure, and I was interested in studying how social class identity matters for the way people interpret politics. So I was not looking for what I am about to tell you about. But what I did was to carve up the state of Wisconsin into different regions depending on economics and politics and demographics. And then I sampled a community in several communities in each of those regions. These are the 27 communities that I spent time in. What I did was to call up a local resident in a given community that I had sampled, sometimes a local newspaper editor, sometimes someone who worked in the county extension office, and I said, where in such and such Wisconsin do people go to visit with one another that I might get access to? Because I study political understanding, and over the course of my career, I have found that the best way to get at that is to listen to people talk to each other in the places that they normally spend time. So I ended up inviting myself into conversations in these places that I'm showing you pictures of here. Gas stations, diners, sometimes places of worship, sometimes several other types of places. And since 2007, between about 2007 and 2012, I visited 39 groups in these 27 communities multiple times. In the past year, I have again gone back to many of these groups, and so I will shed some light on what I heard in those groups. But basically what I did was to drive up to a gas station early in the morning, park my car, take a deep breath, walk in, and say, hi, I'm Kathy from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Do you mind if I join you this morning? And they would laugh. You are all very politely not laughing, but they would laugh and say sure and welcome me in. And then I would give them a business card, ask if I could record the conversation, give them a token of my appreciation. And then I asked them, tell me, what are the big concerns in your community these days? What are you thinking about? What are you talking about? And several rounds of visits in, I became particularly interested in what I was hearing in the small towns and rural communities in Wisconsin. You can probably tell from my accent already that I am familiar with Wisconsin. I spent most of my time and most of my life in Wisconsin. But this perspective really surprised me. And basically, it was a perspective of deep resentment among people in rural places and small towns toward the cities. So I'm going to explain what that looked like and then tell you the implications that I think it has for public policy and on really, when we often talk about this in terms of why is it that the working class is voting against their interests? So this is what it sounded like. This resentment was not, it was complex. It had several major aspects to it, and basically one was a resentment towards the fact, that they had little decision-making power. They felt as though the important decisions that were being made about their life were made by distant people in cities, and that there was little listening going on in reverse. So I'm going to show you another map of Wisconsin here, just to explain a little bit what they're talking about. Madison, the state capital, kind of in the southern central part of the state, and Milwaukee are the two main urban centers in the state, the two main metropolitan areas. The other dots on the map, you could call them cities, but they are in basically what we call outstate Wisconsin. It's the non-metro part of the state. And you can tell that there's a lot of geography in Wisconsin outside the metro areas. Well, folks were saying, you know, decisions are made down in Madison, communicated out to the rest of us, with little listening going on in reverse. So it was this resentment about power. It was also a resentment about resources, where public dollars go. I heard the way this was often put to me was, you know, Madison sucks in all of our taxpayer dollars, spends them on itself or on Milwaukee, and we just don't see that money coming back to us in return. So it was resentment about power and resources, but it was also resentment about respect. That is to say, many times folks would say to me, look, you city people just don't get it. You don't understand what we value. You don't understand what our concerns are or what our way of life is like. And the problem is, you people with your city values who don't understand us are making decisions that affect our lives and affect our lives greatly. So how does this matter for public policy? I'll spin out several ways, but really what I'm going to focus on is how this perspective really sets very fertile ground for small government candidates, candidates who are right-leaning. You may be thinking to yourself, Trump is not a small government candidate, so I'll come back to that in a moment. But the politician whom we have experienced in Wisconsin before Trump is Scott Walker, who sort of surprised the state by winning the governorship in 2010. And he did it by tapping into the following narratives, if you will. So one is that people would say to me, coming from this perspective, look, it's not the case that we oppose government programs, that we oppose government spending in general. But if you ask us to pay more taxes, that money is not going to come back to us or to communities like ours. So for example, people would say, we value our schools. For example, if you take away our school, our community is basically done. Look around here, pretty much everything has evaporated except for the school. We care about our school, but we're not going to pay higher taxes for education because that money isn't going to pay for education here in our community. That was the perception. And so in that perspective, you know, there's little support for new government programs, new government spending. Another narrative is that people had an impression that government is an urban thing. About 10% of the workforce in any Wisconsin municipality is employed by a government, local, county, state, federal. And yet people perceived that those folks do their jobs according to urban decisions. So the public school teachers, local, maybe lived there decades, maybe all their lives, but there was an impression that they were doing their jobs according to urban decisions and urban values or urban policies. Finally, the thing I wanted to touch on is really in my mind where race comes into this. And it's this notion of who's deserving and who's working hard in the population. So in these small towns, when I'd be sitting with people in a gas station and they'd be saying to me, look around at our community, look at how things are so different here than they were in the past. Our farms are done, our local businesses are done. And they'd say, we just don't get it. We're working so hard to make ends meet. We're working multiple jobs in order to do so. And we can't afford, for example, health insurance. And you're asking us to pay higher taxes so that our money can go to pay for health insurance for public employees who sit behind a desk all day? Not fair. Doesn't make sense. So it was this deep sense of injustice that was often, you know, targeted to people they perceived as less deserving or less hardworking. Certainly when people are talking about those people in the cities, that's a racist claim many times, because especially in Wisconsin we have a very racially segregated state. But they're also talking about the so-called urban elite. They're talking about me. They know that I'm a professor at the state university, and so it's sort of a resentment about a variety of people in society that they think are less deserving, or you might argue have been taught are less deserving or told are less deserving. So what's the appeal of Donald Trump to this? How did Donald Trump do so well in Wisconsin? In these rural areas, what I have heard people saying to me is that Donald Trump represents change, right? To them, Donald Trump came onto the scene and said, you are right. You are right to feel like you're not getting your fair share. You're right to be angry. You are hardworking Americans. And you're right to think that you are deserving, and what you deserve is going to others, undeserving others. Vote for me, and I will make America great again. And so, through all of this, I'm sure, especially for this group of people, you may be saying to yourself, but they're not necessarily right, right? For example, what about the allocation of public resources in Wisconsin? Is it really the case that rural communities get less than their fair share? When you look at that data, on a per capita basis in particular, it's not necessarily the case that rural places get less than their fair share, meaning they don't, on average, get fewer tax dollars with respect to state allocations or federal allocations. And they also don't get less than their fair share when you take into account what they're paying in to state and federal taxes. And for me, what that suggests, and as I've heard in various comments today, is that it is these perceptions or this perspective of what's going on in the world that really matters. We may lament the fact that actual empirics or actual fact or reality matters not so much for some of these calculations, but that is a reality, that it's the perceptions or the perspectives that matter so much. So hopefully that sheds some light on how it might be the case that the working class folks themselves are playing some role in, what shall we say, the stagnancy of their own flourishing. But again, thank you for having me here. It's a pleasure.
I don't quite know how to manage this, and that is going to let me take a few minutes into your 25-minute break, since we started a few minutes late. So, of our three speakers and of the previous four, if there are any questions, why don't we start? And the idea here is questions to somebody, not speeches. And I'll start with you.
Yeah, thank you so much for the microphone. Thank you.
Yes, hello. This is a question to Professor Cramer. And I would like to, if you could tell us a little bit more about the demographics of Wisconsin. What type of population is there? Basically white or the average? Yes? I don't know.
Yes. It's very white.
Also the percentage of the population living in rural areas with respect to those.
Sure. So, overall, according to 2010 census, about 82% of the population in Wisconsin was non-Hispanic white. In some of these rural counties, it's as high as 96-98%. So quite white in general. The racial minorities are heavily concentrated in the Madison and Milwaukee metro area, African American population, especially in the Milwaukee metro area. There is a growing Latino population, primarily in the southeastern part of the state. Really, very, very few Latino Americans in the northern third of the state. But there are significant other racial and ethnic populations too in Wisconsin that you don't hear about as much. And that one is Native Americans. We have 11 reservations in Wisconsin, primarily in the north. And then also we have a significant Hmong population, who refugees who came to Wisconsin as well as to Minnesota and parts of California too after the Vietnam War, and there's been several waves of that immigration. So primarily white, but you know, size, important racial and ethnic populations too.
And for those of you, I would do this for anyone who came up who spoke here. If I knew all of their recent work, and in any case, everybody already knows Alan Krueger's work. But Professor Cramer has published a book called The Politics of Resentment about this study, which is a marvelous book. I'll go to this side, sir. The one furthest, yeah, you.
Okay, great. My name is Alex Hurtle Fernandez, and I'm a faculty member here at CEPA at Columbia. So my question is for Professor Cramer and Dr. Weil. I was hoping you could talk a little bit about the labor movement, which I felt was a little bit noticeably absent from this panel, given that it's focused on kind of worker power and worker well-being. For Professor Cramer, could you talk a little bit about the cutbacks to labor union collective bargaining rights that have happened in Wisconsin, and then maybe reflect a little bit on whether or not a revived labor movement could provide the sort of workers who you describe in your book with the sort of voice that they would need to channel their discontent into politics, perhaps in a way that would be productive to their economic interests. And for Dr. Weil, I was wondering if you could reflect a little on the implications of the fissured workplace for worker power as expressed through the labor movement, and whether there are possibilities for rebuilding the labor movement despite the fact that we're seeing this fissuring.
He got in two questions there, and that wasn't supposed to be allowed. Professor Cramer, you get a minute.
Sure.
Professor Weil, you get a minute.
Thanks, Alex. So there's been significant restrictions on labor unions in Wisconsin. So after Scott Walker became governor, Act 10 legislation implemented shortly thereafter that cut back the collective bargaining rights for most public employee unions and required public employees to pay in quite a bit more to their pension and health care, our pension and health care benefits. There's no doubt that if that were re-energized, that would make a huge difference. Often what I hear in rural parts of the state is that labor union membership seems to be a key thing distinguishing between whether folks are voting for a Democrat or a Republican. There's still a very strong memory of the power of the union and the importance and just the quality of life that it provided to folks. And there's a pretty prominent recollection that the Democratic Party was much more supportive of that than the Republican Party. So I think re-energizing that would make a big, huge difference.
David?
So the fissured workplace has major implications to not only unions, but I would just say the notion of collective voice. Yes. By breaking apart the employment relationship in the way it has, if you look at the National Labor Relations Act is what governs collective bargaining and union organizing. There's lots of research out there to show that it's very difficult to organize union in the context of sort of classic employment relationships with simple employer-employee relationships. It's even more complicated now because of the fact that bargaining structures can get very small very quickly because of the fissuring of the workplace. What I would say more generally, and it certainly affects my agency, the National Labor Relations Board is independent of the Labor Department. But in terms of the basic rights on minimum wage and overtime, our statutes give people the right to complain. There's a private right of action embodied in the Fair Labor Standards Act. What we find is workers in these fissured structures are very unlikely to exercise their rights because of the fact they're isolated, the work relationship tends to be very precarious. I've done research years ago about the fact that you often find the exercise of rights is very contingent on the presence of a third-party agent, usually a union. And so the absence of that in many fissured workplaces means that it undermines the ability to actually exercise basic rights of complaint under a whole variety of statutes. I won't go into it, but both the National Labor Relations Board has looked into how do you deal with that in this environment. We've certainly tried to change our approach very much in light of the problem that you raise.
I want to take 60 seconds to give you a third perspective on this one, which is different from these two. And that is, if you look at this exponential change, what is happening is companies are shrinking. The number of people it takes to produce $1 billion in value is shrinking exponentially along with technology. You go to the four plants of the 1920s and there, 100,000 workers. That's more than is in all of Google worldwide. As companies are shrinking because of Kozel's law, working theorem, working in reverse, you have smaller and smaller and smaller companies. Unions were put into place to even the playing field between large numbers of workers and a small number of big companies. Now that the number of companies, the companies are getting smaller and smaller and more of them, there is less need for the union in that sense, and there's less ability because there's nobody to negotiate with. And so you're going to see unions effectively evaporating. So that labor world, I think, is not going to be a player going forward.
Way over there.
So we have 70% of people are not going to be needed to work. They're going to be home with diabetes and opioids. Can anybody recommend a book that someone has sat down and tried to envision what's an alternative future? You know, on an ideal point of view. And rather than all these, complaining, what should it look like?
Well, as it happens, Bob Lighton, who is an economist and a friend, and I wrote a e-book called The Good Economy, and you could go and look at it. But there are lots of people who've come close to the 70% number. I mean, Tyler Cowen's book, The End of Ordinary, while he doesn't solve the problem, comes at it a slightly different way and comes to about the same kind of number. Sir, you were going to ask.
Yes, yes. I just...
You're going to need that. No one can hear you.
You made a very fascinating presentation, but I think that you are challenging an idea which is as old as economics, which is the fact that technology destroys employment. It has been destroying employment at any time in the past, and it will destroy probably employment at a more rapid pace. And I agree with you that probably there is an acceleration of innovation, and the pace of innovation is very important for employment. But what we have been taught in economics is that the economy is creating services. Services. This is my question. It's creating services, and services created in income, new services, income, and so on and so on. So you are challenging that.
Absolutely. So I hear what you're saying, and I will tell you, in the interest of full disclosure, that Ray Kurzweil, who was the god of exponential technology, agrees with you, right? Now, he created something called Singularity University, and I created the track in economics and finance there. And on this one, Ray agrees with you, and I disagree. I believe that for the first time, historically, yes, you had technology increasing employment, right? But we have now passed the knee of the curve, and what you're seeing is now you're not seeing technology. What kind of new jobs is tech? It's not from Uber drivers, right? What kind of new jobs is technology creating? STEM jobs for the top 9%, not the bottom.
Simon had wanted to.
Yeah, I want to say something. I admire Mr. Rose's achievements as an entrepreneur, but I have to say that Ray Kurzweil is a crank. I'm inclined to think he's a charlatan. But if you doubt that, have a look on YouTube of the exchange between John Searle of the University of California and Kurzweil, because in my view, John, 30 years ago, explained why you can proliferate the power of computers ad nauseum, but they still remain, in terms of intelligence, totally dumb, without intelligence, because the symbols of computers have no semantic value. They do not connect with any object or concept in the real world. The connection with the real world is provided by us. Whatever intelligence these systems have come from us. And actually, Kurzweil had no answer to that. What he said was, and you can look on YouTube, well, we may not have it now, but guess what? We're going to have it in 30 years' time. Now, Professor Miller, a great distinguished neurosurgeon at Columbia, said, we may have it in 1,000 years at the rate we're going, but the idea that we have it 2045 is moonshine. And I think a conference of this caliber, I must say that.
I've told David that he couldn't answer because I'm hoping there's some other questions.
We'll see in 30 years.
We'll see. Right there. But remember, it's a question.
It's a question. It's a genuine question. I'm not trying to make a point. I'm curious whether this resentment is something that's new and Trump just managed to tap into it, because I didn't hear any. What did you see that, did you see anything that's been changing in the last 4 years that would cause the resentment to boil over, or is it just something that Trump managed to tap into? I also want to point out to Saskia that the notional derivatives have fallen by a factor of 4 since 2006, so the world must be 4 times better than it used to be by that metric.
Okay. Thank you.
I would say the resentment is certainly not new to 2016, and it wasn't even new to 2010, when Walker ran for governor. I've only been doing my fieldwork since 2007, and I've been trying to capture the resentment in kind of longer-term indicators of public opinion before the time of surveys. And I don't have a great sense of when it began, but probably you all have a sense that, you know, for decades it's been gaining steam, right? Probably since the difficulties, I think Professor Phelps talking about the early 70s at the beginning of today, right? That something has been brewing for a long time. So, some politicians, whether they calculate it and know to tap into it or just say the right thing at the right moment in history, it's hard to know.
Others? Sir. What?
I'll respond to
her. She's to respond.
Okay.
I think that
I thought you were pointing to the person.
Right.
If you're in the microphone, of course.
yes, they fell, but they still represent a real tool. And number two, I was really looking at the emergence of this whole platform, you know, that needs the center of the city. It revives the city, and it produces all kinds of major transformations. So I mentioned the derivatives because it is an impressive instrument, you must admit, how it can escalate value. And at one point, it was a quadrillion, even if it has a lot lost, you know, after the big crisis. This is just for the fun of it, huh?
Do we give it back to you?
No, it's to them.
There we go. Right.
Okay, this is the last question, and then you all get
the question.
Good.
Hello, my name is David Adler. It's a question for the panel, actually, and that is missing institutions in the U.S. labor market, things that have worked well elsewhere, such as German manufacturing institutes or apprenticeships. What missing institutions do you see in U.S. labor that could improve things?
Who's going to want to respond to this? Certainly you. Do you want to, Simon?
Yeah.
So, okay, we'll have two responses.
I think it's a huge issue. One of the ones is you allude to, and that is the training function. If you think about certainly industries, businesses that have fissured, the incentives to do job-specific training diminish tremendously if those people increasingly are working inside your walls but are not your employees. And, you know, the whole structure of whether it's benefits, healthcare provision, and then the provision of training is really undermined in terms of how we have traditionally structured it. So you need, there are a lot of proposals, discussions about the portability of pensions that have been happening over the last few years. Obviously, the Affordable Care Act, I think, is an important step forward in thinking about the portability of healthcare benefits. But things like training and upskilling, and I would even put, and it goes back to the notion of agency, at least as I understand it, workplaces are fundamental places of creating social networks. And I've heard in many places in my current capacity, workers who are staffing agent employees say they feel they are outside of the workplaces where they work. And I think that reflects something very real, that you don't get the kind of implicit training and social network creation in these more fissured workplaces than we had historically. I think that requires us to think institutionally, how do we provide some other form of providing those kinds of
a non-union union.
Simon is going to make a comment, and then Alan wanted to.
I think the high ends of the German engineering industry, in particular the car industry, are the classic example of how institutional arrangements can push the technological level to a high level, strong unions, sophisticated unions, works councils, co-determination, and above all, a legally enforced and very advanced training system. The result is high-wage car workers.
Just to add a little bit to that, I think the labor market abhors a void. So as unions fell, occupational licensing rose, which was a much more inefficient way of achieving, I wouldn't even say the same, something in the same space, but that's an institution that has grown dramatically. About 30% of workers are required to have a license to do their job. University professors are sort of the last bastion that that's not. And there's very little evidence that all of this licensing has actually improved quality for customers. One institution which I thought might have actually changed a bit after the auto bailout is part of the auto bailout, the Chrysler and General Motors were required to put a worker representative on the board, which has worked, I think, pretty well from what I've heard. And I thought that might have spread, more. Then the last thing I'll mention is another one of David's and my classmate, Sarah Horowitz, who started the Freelancers Union. So more and more workers are on their own, and they're not interacting with others, which I think is going to be a bigger issue in the future. And they're really not represented. And what the Freelancers Union has done is to negotiate for them to get life insurance, to get health insurance, and in New York to require contractors to pay within 30 days. And that's something that one can imagine because that's outside of the NLRA structure. So one can imagine that growing in the future. But I think that the decline in traditional unions is part of the reason why we saw the Gingrich Revolution in 94 and part of the reason why we saw what occurred in the election, because the group that would have belonged to traditional AFL-CIO union would have been organized to vote in their economic interest as opposed to based on their emotions.
Can I
add
one more
item?
If
it's...
The question was very important. I wish the question would have come sooner. Okay,
I'll just shout. You just shout.
Yeah, I think that the other critical issue is that we need to reduce the franchising. The franchising really, I mean, sometimes we need it, but it is an extractive sector. You know, it takes out something of the consumption capacity and the making capacity of a locality. So I am all for that as well, to add.
I'm going to end it. There's this phenomenon that occurs for the last panels in a conference, which is people, some people like you all leave. And therefore, it's really unfair to the last speaker. So you got 10 minutes to get coffee and stuff, and then we move to the last panel. Thank you all.